he invites me in every year to talk about veterans and how we can kind of show our appreciation for veterans. And we all kind of are clear on what on who veterans are. Is that people that are, I consider people that are serving, people that are, we should be thinking about tomorrow as well. So veterans are people that have served in the past, but I like to think of people that are, you know, continuing to serve in the military in some shape or form. So you got the Army, Marines, the Air Force, the Navy, and the Coast Guard, all kind of playing a role there. And I was in the Army for about 6 years, and during that time there was a war called Desert Storm, that was in, it was fighting near Iraq. I was stationed in Saudi Arabia, so that's kind of all the way around the world there. Considered Southwest Asia. There it is. And I don't know if, I was in Dahran, which, boy, the spelling, I'm not sure if I know.
Yeah. Was it by Kuwait City? I mean, was it across
a little bit south there? So you're probably, that's probably right in this area in here.
Yeah.
So in the middle of the desert, was deployed in October. We were just getting ready to start our football season. I just started playing football again. I was playing on the Fort Lewis football team, full pads and everything, because I grew up playing soccer. And we were just getting ready to play our first football game, and we got the order to deploy, so we didn't get to play football. So, a little bit about my background. I went to St. John's University for 2 years. Who's heard of St. John's? Okay. And I loved St. John's, but I wasn't sure what I wanted to do. And I wasn't really all that disciplined. Mr. E shared with me how wonderful this class and how disciplined you guys are. I mean, discipline's like self-control, grit, and I didn't have as much as I needed to. So if you've got it, keep building it. If you don't have it, work to build it some more. So after 2 years at St. John's, kind of expensive, didn't know what I wanted to do, I decided to enlist in the Army. And I kind of wanted to go to Europe, so I enlisted. I didn't really care what job I had, but I wanted to go to Europe. So I was stationed in Germany for 2 years, then moved on to Fort Lewis, Washington, and that's where I was deployed from the Desert Storm in Saudi Arabia. Was there for almost a year, and in fact, while I was there, my oldest son, Teddy, was born. And I think that's a good one for you guys to think about. Is oftentimes, the soldiers, the men and women in uniform that are deployed over somewhere like that, it can be tough. But it's really tough for the people that are behind. So the family that's behind, the children of the servicemen and women, the spouses of the servicemen and women. For my wife then, who had, you know, a newborn, first newborn, to be there without my help, you know, couldn't hand Teddy to me and say, your turn to change the diaper. She had to do all of them. So that was really tough on her. And that's usually how it is. When you're the serviceman and the service member, in the action, you've got a job to do, and you're pretty busy. Back home, it's where it can be kind of tough. Desert Storm lasted, the war itself didn't last too long. It was not too serious of a conflict, different than the most recent conflicts in Afghanistan and Iraq. I did get injured. I had my leg in a cast for about 6 weeks. Do you want to hear about the war injury?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, as I mentioned, it didn't last too long, and the war had just ended. And the next day, even, I was out in the middle of the desert, and are you guys sure you're ready for this gruesome stuff?
Yeah.
I was playing basketball.
What?
Yeah, I was playing basketball against Marvin Lacey. Marvin was from Alabama, and we were kind of competitive against each other. We were playing one-on-one. It was down to the final point. I was up by 1 point, and if I made my next bucket, I would beat Marvin Lacey from Alabama. And I went up for my shot, and I landed straight on the top of my foot and rolled it straight down and heard a big and I was down a heap, crying like a baby, probably crying like Teddy was back home. And all of a sudden, my ankle went, and so I was in the hospital for 3 days with my ankle up on traction.
Is this Freebird's reading room?
fill you in. So I had my foot up in traction until the swelling could go down. So raise it up above your head. So gravity. You guys know gravity, right?
Yeah.
Wait, gravity is what when you jump up makes it come back down. Yeah. So gravity mate brought all that swelling out, and then they put it in a cast for 6 weeks. Anybody had a leg or an arm in a cast? What after a few weeks, what happens in there? Does it get itchy?
Yeah.
Does it start to stink a little bit? Yeah. Imagine a cast 6 weeks in the desert where it's 110 degrees every day.
Oh,
man, the people could smell me coming from about the football field away.
Oh, here comes Rose again.
Woo! So, was in a cast, walking around the desert for 6 weeks, and then I finally got that out. And, but a couple things I stand out for me during the war. There was a time when there were missiles coming inbound. They were called Scud missiles. And they didn't know if they had chemicals in them or not. And we had these whole get-ups that you put on. It was a big green, almost like a snowmobile suit. And it was lined with charcoal. And that would help with the chemicals. And then they had a gas mask that you put on and a big hood over. And we practiced all the time how to do this. So that you could do it with your eyes closed. And you want your eyes closed in case there's chemicals. You don't get the chemical in your eyes, right? So we practice and we practice and we get really good at it. And we were sitting in our mess tent, they call it, which is where you eat. And there were picnic tables. And I was at the back of the tent. The door was up that way. And we actually had a TV in the tent. We were watching CNN, I think. And all of a sudden the sirens went off, which meant a Scud missile was coming in. And they didn't know if it had chemicals. So it was a chemical alarm, which meant go get just suit on. And I distinctly, remember looking around and everybody kind of going, whoa, what do we do? This is the first time it had happened. And I grabbed my corporal. I was a sergeant. And so we were in charge of 12 soldiers. I was a squad leader. He was assistant squad leader. I grabbed Corporal Keffer from Pennsylvania, big Steelers fan. Grabbed him, and we literally ran across the tops of the tables out and just got to our tents and got in our gear. And I remember looking around. First of all, there were people in there that froze, didn't know what to do. And there were others that just did. In my squad of 12, two just kind of melted down, didn't know what to do. And we had to literally help them get in their gear. Once we got in our gear, we had to help them. And others just rose to the occasion. And it wasn't who I expected it was going to be. And the interesting thing there is I think wartime can bring out unexpected traits from people. And it's not even good or bad. You know, when it's that serious, obviously if there's chemicals, you don't know if you're going to live or die. And so some of us panic. But I think universally, you've heard the term patriotic, mm-hmm. love of country. And that is certainly present in the Army when I was there. But I think more than that, we're doing it for the person that's next to us. We're doing what we do to help them, to keep them safe. And they're doing what they're doing to help us and keep us safe and to accomplish the mission. So I've got a couple pictures I can turn around. This will give you a little bit of an idea of what the desert looks like. We had some higher ranking folks come in. One is the Sergeant Major of the Army. I'm the younger looking one at that point.
So you want to put him under that?
Oh,
you want to put him on that.
Sure.
There you go.
I've never used one of these before.
Yeah. And then, let's see if it focuses right away. Or there we go. That's pretty good. Yeah.
Hey, my thumb. Cool.
And then, okay, Mr. Right, Rose, right. Yeah, there you go. Excellent.
So this is the Sergeant Major of the Army. I can't remember his name. And this is me. Luckily, it's not a very clear picture because there's no gray hair there, though, and no chin music there, just a mustache. Interesting thing about the Army, by the way. We have uniforms. By the way, I'd love to have uniforms for students.
No.
How many of you would like to have uniforms? Oh, that's much higher than fifth grade. Fifth grade,
nobody
wants uniforms. I express myself how I dress, is their answer, which I get. But uniforms, it's very, sideburns between the top of the ear and the bottom. Mustache, you can have one. Got to be back from the edge of the mouth. tucking your pants in your boots? Yes, everybody does. Okay, you're gonna roll up your sleeve, you roll it a certain way. Haircut, yep, it's gotta be tapered down by the ears and everything. I mean, everything is looks the same. Which is interesting. I can't judge any one of my fellow soldiers based on if they've got the newest Nikes or not. Or based on if they've got the new Era possibly sweatshirt. Or Abercrombie and Hooch, or whatever that is. Can I judge their action? Absolutely. Can I judge their performance? You bet. And I would argue that that's a more substantial way to judge than judging appearance. By the way, I would never judge the people. I leave that to a higher power. But I judge how they would treat me. I judge their performance. Wouldn't it be refreshing in school if the only thing being judged is how well you treat each other, how well you perform, how BBA you are. Have you ever heard that term, BBA?
Yeah.
No? Oh, you have? Oh, it's up there. There it is. Rather than if we've got the newest Nikes or the newest Era possibly, whatever. So just interesting side note. I think it's interesting. So that's that one. This is when we got to meet General Carl Vono. He's a four-star general. He was the Army Chief of Staff.
Oh, my.
And so you can see the four stars right there and up here. To kind of get an idea of the tents we slept in, the big, pretty big tents. Kind of it's a desert environment. It would be 110, 115 degrees during the day, so pretty warm. But it was a very dry heat, which might sound interesting. But it's not as oppressive as you'd think. How many of you have been in really hot weather in the summer? Does anybody ever get like their shirt gets a little bit damp from sweating? You would never have a damp shirt there.
Oh my.
Because it would evaporate instantly. You know what evaporate means? It means where the water kind of is, well, it's evaporated. And that's actually how your body, how sweat cools you. The evaporation is what cools you. That's why when it's more humid and your sweat does not evaporate, it feels warmer. Because your body isn't as efficient at cooling itself. So you never have a damp shirt even though it's 110, 115 degrees. So your body's pretty efficient at cooling, but you need lots of fluids. About a liter of water in a plastic bottle looks like that. Have you ever seen 2 liter plastic bottles? Yeah. We need to drink about 7 or 8 of those a day. How warm do you think the water is? About 110 degrees. There was no refrigeration. And I was obviously in charge of 12 soldiers, like I mentioned. And the way we would test to see if the kids, the soldiers were getting up water is we would look at their urine. Yeah, urine test. If it was dark yellow or brown, they weren't drinking enough water. If it was lighter, they were drinking enough water. So that, you know, that's how we tested. And it took about 2 or 3 weeks for people to kind of get in the rhythm of, okay, this is how much water I need to drink. I need to force myself to drink 110 degree water. They had Kool-Aid packets, if you wanted. That made it worse. 110 degree Kool-Aid. Ugh. Terrible. And after about 2 or 3 months, then we were able to get some refrigeration in there, and having cool water made a huge difference. So the war ended, came back. Then I went to the University of Minnesota after I got out of the Army. Received a good kick in the rear end after 5 years or so in the Army. My discipline was better, my self-control, my grit, my desire to do well. I decided I didn't want to make a career in the Army. It wasn't for me. And so I was more motivated to do well in school and get my teaching degree and then start teaching. So that's kind of my background, my story. Does anybody know any veterans in their family? Or friends? Or anybody that's currently serving? Okay. So I don't know if Mr. E told you, but I have homework for you.
What?
He said you guys love homework. Your homework?
I do.
Your homework is to figure out a way to say thank you to that person. Okay. And it might be a phone call. Nice thing about phone calls this day and age, if you have a cell phone, long distance calls don't really cost anything. Most probably don't.
Matter. Yeah, right.
Okay. Anybody have email at home? Maybe you can email them. If I was going to thank my father, I might write just a little note, or I might write it on that label that I can wear to my father's passed away. But he was in the Marines during the Korean War. So even if they passed away, you can thank them in your mind, and who knows, maybe just somehow, some way, they'll get the message, if you know what I mean. Okay. Questions? Do you have questions about my service or anything?
Yeah.
In the other picture, you look just like my dad.
Your dad is ruggedly good looking and cool. Your dad must be a lot younger than me then, right now. Yeah.
He's 36.
Oh yeah, he's a lot younger. Yeah. Any questions about my experience in the Army, or I can't remember, what are some of the things I've covered in your
The one thing that I find fascinating is the story. I'll ask you more about the football later, but the thing that I found fascinating is the day that you did actually run into
fire.
You, kind of your job.
Yeah.
When you were,
Okay, so one of my, my job before I was deployed was I was a physical fitness instructor. I basically did like a rope, bless you. I basically did like aerobics for 150 soldiers every day. So it's for the whole company. Different levels of squad 12, a platoon of like 48 or so, and then there's four platoons in like a company. Company's about 150 soldiers, give or take. So every morning at about 0600, 6 o'clock, we would assemble and I would lead physical fitness instructor. I'd make them do push ups, I'd make them do jumping jacks. We call them side straddle hops in the Army. I take them on a run for 2 miles, and I call cadence. You guys know what cadence is? Where I say something, you repeat it. I don't know what I've been told.
I don't know what I've been told.
Mystery's as good as gold.
Mystery's as good as gold.
I don't know, but I've heard rumors.
I don't know, but I've heard rumors.
Mr. Dreyke's wearing blue.
Mr. Dreyke's wearing
blue. And you do that, and you're running the whole time. And it kind of makes you forget about what you're doing. Kind of motivate, build a spree core. Okay. Well, the other thing I did was a kind of a, almost like a counselor, give professional guidance, try to get soldiers to reenlist, sign up for more years. But in a wartime environment, there's not really a need for physical fitness instruction or for reenlistment in the field. So I was what they call a sergeant of the guard. Sergeant of the guard was a position that was on for 24 hours, off for 48 hours. Well, off for 24 to 48 hours, somewhere in there. And when I was on for 24 hours, I would have soldiers that would be, let's pretend this is our base in the middle. You've got the perimeter, right? Have you ever heard the word perimeter?
Yeah.
Which subject have you heard that in? Math. Around the outside, right?
Yes.
So you've got the perimeter, and you've got this, you put up barbed wire. And we'd have these little, what we call bunkers, and they've got sandbags. And then we'd have guards there, and they'd guard what's outside the perimeter. Guard here by, you know, looking outside. My job was to make sure those soldiers knew where they were there on time. When they weren't there, they'd be on 2 hours, off for 4 hours, for 24 hours. So when they're on for 2 hours, I'd make sure they're in the right spot, I'd make sure they know what their lanes of fire are, make sure they get food, the whole nine yards. I bring the next crew out, relieve those, they'd be off for a little bit. So for 24 hours. And one time, we had a van drive by, probably at about, 100 yards away maybe, and the van door opened, all of a sudden, machine gun fire inbound. And bullets make a distinctive sound when they go whizzing by your head. I mean, but you know it, it's distinctive. It gets your attention. And so our bunker returned fire. I'm not sure if we hit the van or not. They didn't hit any of us. And as fast as they drove in, they drove away. And that was that. The biggest challenge of starting the guard was about 2 to 4 in the morning. You'd be really sleepy.
Oh, man.
And to stay awake, we take coffee grounds. You know what you make coffee with? But we take just coffee grounds right in your mouth. And you'd be like, you can cough and spit it out, but it would be a shock to your system and kind of give you a jolt. Or salt right into the tongue, same thing, kind of a shock to the system to kind of keep you awake. So that was that role.
Yeah. That's great.
What do you usually eat there?
Well, for the first couple months, we ate what's called MREs, meals ready to eat. It comes in a little black or dark brown plastic pouch, and a lot of it is dehydrated, so you'd add water to it. They got pretty pretty good with the MREs by the time we went to war. They would add a little bit of Tabasco sauce. I mean, you've heard of Tabasco sauce?
Yeah, yeah.
So that you could add that to just about anything and give it a little bit of flavor, because a lot of it was pretty bland. I never had a problem eating MRE. Some soldiers lost a lot of weight because they were pickier eaters or whatever. They just didn't want to eat them. But I'm not a very picky eater, so I didn't have any problem. That was for about 2 or 3 months. So MRE for breakfast, MRE for lunch, MRE for dinner. And then finally, like I said, about the same time refrigeration came along, we'd have, we call them cookies, the cooks, and they would cook, you know, hot food for us and everything, and that was a huge improvement. Do you have a question?
No.
No. Yes?
Do you have my cousin Dahmer dressed in class?
I do. We call him the Big Dahmer. Yes. Any other questions about Desert Storm or the military or? Your homework assignment? Yep.
What do we have to do for the homework?
You have to, and this is only if you know a veteran or in your family or friends or know somebody that's currently serving, try to figure out a way to say thank you for your service. And if you don't think you know any veterans, ask your folks at dinner tonight. If you're having the meatloaf and they say, hey, Pumpkin, what'd you do today? You say, do they call you Pumpkin?
Yeah.
Honey Boo Boo?
Yeah.
Sweet potato?
Yeah. No.
What do they call you? What do they call you?
Gator.
Gator? I like him. They say, Gator, what are you doing today? You say, well, we had this guy named Mr. Rose come in, and he was pretty ruggedly handsome. But he was talking about Veterans Day, and he gave us an assignment. And the assignment was to try to figure out if there's any veterans we know that, so we can thank them for their service. And they might say, oh, yeah, second cousin Billy Bob and third cousin Betty Lou, they're both dead. Let's figure out a way to contact them.
Thank you, Mr. Rose,
you
so
are
much.
Very
Let's
welcome.
Hear it for him, you guys. That was very, very nice. We really appreciate it.
Great audience. Enjoy the rest of your day.
Yes, thanks. See you later. Thanks so much.